My name is Jeffrey Kahn, and I'm the host of Digital Oil and Gas, the podcast that looks at the impact of digital technology on the oil and gas industry. If you want to discuss this week's topic further, or just stay in touch, you can always reach me at Jeffrey Kahn on Twitter or at jeffreykahn.com. This podcast is entitled, Why Turning Off the Taps is a Fraught Endeavor. During the recent Alberta provincial election campaign, I heard this rallying cry to shut off the taps, to cut the flow of oil through the pipeline that supplies British Columbia with its petroleum. In a marked departure from the normal context of this article series, which is on the impacts of digital on the oil and gas industry, this week I take a look at a recurring call from Alberta's political class to cut the flow of oil products via the Trans Mountain pipeline from Alberta to BC, which is a polite variation of Alberta's bumper sticker from the 1980s, "Let the Eastern Bastards Freeze in the Dark." In case you're not across the backstory, Kinder Morgan, having attempted for years to expand their 300,000-barrel-per-day pipeline to bring more of Alberta's crude oil to the closest coast, sold the pipeline to the Government of Canada. The federal government has permitted the pipeline and bought it to assure that it would be built. Perhaps opposition to the pipeline is somewhat harder once it's in public hands, as it pits one province against another, federal government against provincial governments, and raises constitutional questions of who has what jurisdiction over commerce. The pipeline crosses the Rocky Mountains and delivers 55,000 barrels of crude oil every day to the tiny Parkland refinery in Burnaby. The refinery was owned by Chevron until recently, who, like U.S.-based Kinder Morgan, concluded that better opportunities lay elsewhere and pulled out. Turning off the taps doesn't sound like much of a threat to anti-oil lobbyists in BC, because shutting down the pipeline is exactly what they want, if they assume the pipeline carried only crude oil. What escapes the broader public in BC is that this particular pipeline supplies many different petroleum products from Alberta's refining industrial heartland to BC. And this is tricky, because crude oil for the refinery blends easily with gasoline, jet fuel, and diesel. But this pipeline has ways of keeping the products separated as they flow through the various pumps and lines, emerging in BC in as pristine condition as when they left Alberta. The pipeline plays a critical role in fueling BC's economy and lifestyle. The National Energy Board estimates that the province consumes 96,000 barrels of gasoline every day and 79,000 barrels of diesel fuel. But the refinery in Burnaby isn't nearly big enough to supply all that demand. The balance of the supply is met by the pipeline. I'm reminded of that scene from the Star Wars movie Phantom Menace. The representatives of the Trade Federation wonder if their plan to impose a trade blockade of an entire planet is legal. The Emperor intones, "I will make it legal," with all of the gravity of a fine B-grade villain. Let's be clear, governments block trade all the time. Alcohol for personal consumption can't legally cross many provincial boundaries in Canada. These same kinds of rules are showing up in the new cannabis industry. Employment certificates, teachers' licenses, and business insurance rules block workers from reasonable employment as they cross provincial boundaries. But is it legal to block the trade in a commodity? Well, Bill C-48 will effectively ban the export of crude oil by banning large-scale crude loading, unloading, and tanker traffic on the northern BC coast. The bill targets the shipping method. In the same way, lobbyists that oppose oil pipelines are also aiming at shipping, but not what is shipped. As an aside, Albertans would be interested to know that Bill C-48 doesn't ban all tankers, just those carrying more than 12,500 tons of crude. In this way, BC's two refineries can switch from pipeline supply of crude to title receipts and still stay in business. A ton of crude by weight is about 7 barrels in volume. In other words, the bill is not at all about the environment as it's claimed. The bill looks like it provides for the partial energy security of BC's residents at the expense of economic security for Alberta. Disrupting supply. Canadians occasionally experience an outage in power, but most haven't lived through a disruption in fuel supply. As a rich country with ample energy, Canada does not need to keep on hand large stockpiles of crude oil or finished products. The supply chain is well run. Runouts are rare. Inventories can be kept razor thin. Sure, the odd fuel station might have to shut down a pump, but in general, they're back in business pretty quickly. Well, I was in Australia when a specific fuel used by taxis ran out, and suddenly the entire city of Melbourne, 4 million people, had no taxis. That week, Travelers couldn't get to airports. Patients couldn't get to doctors. Many people on meds shouldn't be driving anyway. But drunks decided to drive themselves home. Australia's economy has just 15 days of inventory in a country largely dependent on imports. And it's likely that BC's fuel supply chain is also tightly managed, if not more so, because energy in Canada is so cheap and abundant. Shut off the taps, and like Melbourne's taxis, the economy would almost immediately slam to a halt, as there is likely no elasticity in the supply chain, no spare inventories. A whole palette of antisocial behaviors are likely to emerge, based on the experience of other markets. Bans on non-essential consumption, unsafe hoarding, arbitrary market allocations, product theft and pilferage, and armed escorts. If the taps are turned off, the refinery would purchase tidal crude to keep the refinery running. No biggie there, C-48 protects the refinery's supply options. But what about the supply of diesel fuel and gasoline? Well, the next available option would be trucks. To supply the missing daily 125,000 barrels of finished products would require an incremental movement of up to 1,500 tank trailer trucks trundling between Alberta and BC, or one departure from Alberta every 3 minutes, assuming there were facilities to load and unload that many trucks every day, traveling over mountain passes frequently closed in the winter. The costs are insane when compared to pipelines, and far more dangerous, but in a pinch, that's what you'd do. BC already pays the highest pump prices in North America. Replace the cheapest way to bring petroleum to the province with the most expensive way, and someone has to pay the extra freight. After a period of adjustment, pricing for petroleum in the province will have to go up. Well, instead of just shutting off the taps, Alberta could fiddle with the taps, like a teenager might to annoy his older sister in the shower. By altering the mix of products that flow down the pipeline, Alberta could induce painful but not crippling levels of market discomfort for BC. And altering the mix could likely be carried out by Alberta's energy regulator. After all, the province has already enacted restrictions on crude production. The pipeline would still be full, product would still be flowing, but the balance would be off. A few days' restriction on marine fuel shipments through the pipeline will force fuel sellers to prioritize traffic. Do they halt the container business from the port, lay over the cruise ship industry, or cancel ferry services to the islands? Industry can pay for vessel demurrage or stockpile at quayside, but the tourism industry is very brand sensitive thanks to the power of social media sites. Tourists will not be kept waiting, and ferry service issues are front page news even when they're running. Vancouver Airport, YVR, is less dependent on Alberta for jet fuel since the airport has alternative supplies already in place because the demand for jet fuel is so strong. Jets will still fly, but the prices to fly to and from Vancouver would spike because it would be so much harder just to get to the airport. BC is very dependent on diesel fuel, what with all of the mines, forestry, and agricultural activity. Rotating shortages during the year could be timed to force hard choices on various sectors. BC's commodity export prices for wood, crops, minerals, and ores are set by the market, and increases in fuel costs might not be transferable to the customer. Gasoline is the biggest petroleum product category, and some well-timed shortages could create real challenges for tourism. BC's ski industry is totally dependent on gasoline, as the vast majority of skiers drive to ski hills. Then again, fewer skiers at Whistler might suit the locals who blame Alberta for climate worries. Rotating manufactured shortages of fuel are hard to plan for. Altering tank allocations at the refinery, beefing up inventories, moving inventories closer to consumption points, and altering supply lines take time and investment. Less fuel consumption means lower tax revenues from both pump sales and declines in economic activity. I personally don't believe in using energy supply as an economic weapon. Energy is a basic human entitlement. Playing with someone's energy security never ends well. When Gazprom halted gas pipeline supplies to Europe because the transit nation Ukraine withheld payment for its gas purchases, then many innocent Europeans froze to death. I consider it immoral to deny energy supplies to a northern climate nation. By politicizing and weaponizing their energy system, Gazprom and the Russian state permanently damaged their brand in the market. But by blocking Alberta's pathway to energy markets, BC and the federal government are slowly freezing Alberta's economy to death, and 100,000 out-of-work and angry Albertans are reaching for the taps. It's clearly time for Alberta, BC, and the federal government to find a compromise to this politically manufactured situation or risk an escalation in tap warfare.
Thanks for listening. If you enjoyed this podcast, be sure to subscribe to the show. You can find Digital Oil and Gas on Apple Podcasts, YouTube, Spotify, Stitcher, or wherever you listen to podcasts. And please tell a friend about the show. If you have a minute, please leave a review and a rating on iTunes, as that helps others find the show along with other great content. You can follow Jeffrey on Twitter, at Jeffrey Can, or on LinkedIn. Also, look for Jeffrey's new book, entitled Bits, Bytes, and Barrels, The Digital Transformation of Oil and Gas, on Amazon and other fine online bookshops. Thanks for listening to this episode of Digital Oil and Gas. The podcast returns next Wednesday, so tune in then.